came up with for this presentation is really several papers, and of course I'm only giving one, but this is really very preliminary for me in terms of situating. I think there really is a whole new relevance to our tone now, and that Rigby's already in the second decade of the 20th century, the way he's had very powerful impact and relevance at different periods. I'm going to touch on just a little bit. And so I'm trying to kind of situate him exactly why that's happening, or why there's a big potential for that with this sort of maybe new media society of digital sensorium, however you want to talk about that. So that's sort of the backdrop of this. And it's a little too preliminary for me, because some of the issues can't really be gone into in a short paper so well, but I think you'll see some of these issues that come out, one of which I think, at least in Deleuze and Guattari's reading, you know, the other big model for body without organs, besides our toe, is Spinoza. And I think if you look in the kind of social, political context of those, there's a very huge bifurcation there in what that might mean. So I think that's something that comes out of this, to an extent. I think it's okay for time. I'll see. Because I usually do have a lot of showing film clips, but I'm not doing any of that. So I hope I didn't go over dose on the text here. But we'll see. I think it's going to work out. We'll see here. But anyway, so one of the most striking aspects of Artaud's legacy, Artaud predicted in 1948, and then this is a quote that Roz has already introduced us to, that his present body would fly into pieces, and under 10,000 notorious aspects, a new body would be assembled in which you will never again be able to forget me. Is that what is most mad and delusional about him in his lifetime, where he was stigmatized as schizophrenic and subjected to electroshock treatments, survives and even thrives today in analyses of contemporary capitalism. To take a few examples, by Philippe Pignat and Isabel Stenger, is Frédéric Niat and the collective Tycoon, where the movements of political economy are indeed nothing less than black magic, as Artaud diagnosed it. For Artaud, who claimed he had been hexed ever since his trek up to the Sierra Tarahumaras to partake in peyote rituals with the Tarahumaras in September 1936, this was a combat of sorcery and counter-sorcery, a desperate cosmological war against demonic invasive forces. Paradoxically, it is this late Artaud, especially after his release from Rodez Asylum in May 1946, that sees himself at war with the occult, whether these are occult representations or occult forces. Artaud, making a strange figure on the Paris Metro, was constantly making signs and heretic gestures, warding off his numerous enemies. The essential, if preliminary, question I'm trying to draw from Artaud has to do with this fiercely debatable role of representation and representational processes that we've heard quite a bit about today so far. Artaud's assault on representation has only solidified and intensified in ferocity at the end of his life in this final Artaud, or late Artaud. And what can possibly constitute a subversion of them in an inexorable digital sensorium? What I'm going to suggest here is that it's this later final Artaud's experience with the Tarahumaras was such a dramatic rupture that one can easily speak of a pre and post Tarahumara Artaud, that in many crucial respects was a total reversal of the early one. What is the one that provides these intriguing inroads into the present? So key to this new relevance is Artaud's ferocious rejection of the occult, systems of which he was deeply immersed in the 1930s especially, or proposal of a counter-occult, counter-sorcery, and the linked transformation and discarding of the whole notion of a matrix of all-powerful hieroglyphics that constitutes the moving forces of the universe that are featured so saliently throughout his famous theater manifestos published in 1938, and that Artaud went to Mexico to witness. He argued that indigenous peoples there were in contact with these primal realities. Artaud's obsession with or advocacy of hieroglyphics makes him, as he realized, part of a crucial current in early and mid-20th century art, whether one looks at Cubism, Abby Warburg's Atlas Project, Sergei Eisenstein films, or Ernst Villanosa and Ezra Pound's use of the Chinese ideogram as a revivifying force for avant-garde poetics. The late Artaud, on the other hand, has few, if any, compliments, indeed. As for his previously dear hieroglyphs, Artaud writes in 1946 that, quote, all the keys of their so-called occultism die out in the finally useless and ominous convolutions of brain matter. In his so-called Associations that Artaud considered his most homely work, He writes, Papa Mama itself will have ceded the place to man, without hieroglyphics and secret keyboard. That is, without signs and without mysticism, without any of the zigzags of sacred geometry, or sometimes Artaud talks about occult geometry, quite frequently in the 20s and 30s. Artaud's reference to brain matter in this devolution or uselessness of the hieroglyphs is far from accidental or fortuitous, since as with the final Artaud, what is at stake is a, quote, harsh and immediate conception of life in which the body is the foundation. End of quote. That's John Joseph Gou on Artaud, who's one of the very, very few people to remark on this dramatic change you get from the early to the later Artaud, on what a transformation that is. Yet with Artaud's invention, our attempted achievement of a body without organs, we know this is not simply merely some assertion of the body against the mind, though an abolition of consciousness is surely Artaud's end goal. In fact, Artaud's melding and destruction of these dualities and creating an outside or virtual body is not only analogous to much current thinking, it inspired a crucial part of it. Chief among this influence is Deleuze's theory of cinema, where it is the brain itself that becomes the surface for struggle and contestation. In following Artaud in the matter that culture is a function of the nerves, the dilemmas of current cinema for Deleuze were based in the circuitry of the brain. Quote, the circuits and linkages of the brain don't pre-exist the stimuli, corpuscles, and particles that trace them. The linkages are paradoxical and on all sides overflow simple association of images, to Deleuze explained. This was key to the power and efficacy of cinema, since, quote, cinema, precisely because it puts the image in motion, or rather endows the image with self-motion, never stops tracing the circuits of the brain. This characteristic can be manifested either positively or negatively. This was the sense of Deleuze maintaining that in the current electronic or media-dominated sensorium, quote, bodies in nature or people in a landscape are replaced by brains in a city. With Forbes magazine's prediction in 2003 that given neuroscience developments, brain imaging companies would start to vet TV shows and movies, this realm of the neurobiological or neurobiopolitical revolves around, quote, the ability to sculpt the physical matter of the brain and its abstract counterpart, the mind. This is the case given the research in neuroscience that has especially blossomed since 1987 by Jean-Pierre Changeau at the Pasteur Institute in Paris and expanded by Nobel laureate Gerald Edelman in San Diego that has explored the crucial role of environment and culture in the widest sense in the configuration of the human nervous system. These studies have led to new conclusions about how neurons and their synapses and dendrites adapt and change due to new experience. In short, neuronal assemblages that are fired and stimulated more often acquire more efficient means of transmission, outmaneuvering other neuronal networks, lending their theorization the appropriate name of neural selectionism or neural Darwinism. This neuronal activity that is brought out by various complex systems of stimuli take on new importance when linked to the various analyses of biopolitics, what Foucault described as the unprecedented contemporary attempt to leverage and control all aspects of human and biological life in a governmental order. As opposed to disciplinary societies that used regimes of punishment to regulate citizens into pre-established patterns from outside, in what Deleuze called the new societies of control, these powers are now networked in far more subtle controls of behavior so they reach across the social field to saturate the brains, consciousness, and bodies of individuals. The erasure of borders and inner-outer boundaries of this process entails the universe entering into the realm described by Artaud, who also in his band Radio Work to Have Done with the Judgment of God, 1947-48, identifies this realm as one dominated by technoscience, monotheism, and a perpetual war economy, tendencies that only are exacerbated today in the war on terror. It is in this crisis of complete invasion that Artaud invents in the middle of his asylum confinement his body without organs. Confident that he was onto something, it was at the dawn of the atomic age that Artaud proclaimed a new body will be assembled. This body may have begun as a hieroglyphic process with Artaud's extraordinary interjection into his body of the figure of the cross. Artaud writes at one point, I am the vertebral cross. An eventual subversion and an expulsion of it. It's an really extraordinary process Artaud goes through in the asylums that one psychoanalyst, who was actually a Lacanian psychoanalyst, ironically called absolutely unprecedented what Artaud did in the asylums in terms of reforming himself beyond mere survival. So Artaud's rejection of Christianity in particular, and usurping the figure and suffering of Christ, is central to this expulsion. And Artaud writes, "I will shed for eternity the soul of Christ, Jesus Christ, and his Antichrist, his body." This new body is above all a doubling, and for Artaud was intensely living language in its physicality and in his body. Quote, "The mystery of the verb and the mystery of the body are the same. They come from an incoercibility that wrings itself from itself from base to base." Artaud's body without organs is therefore a double feat, a double creation of reorganization of soma, psyche, and creative language, where expression becomes, quote, "a mass of flesh moving in and through the general anatomy," end quote. He comes to constitute another outside, another boundary that Artaud creates through a process of expelling himself from himself. I am not inside," Artaud writes. "The body without organs thus becomes," as he writes, "an exterior body." Just as Artaud does not dispute ordinary chronological time, it seeks nonetheless to exist in another, multiple, and eternal sense of time. Artaud recognizes the organ body while posing distance from it as an entity that can only be defined by being, God, or the other of Lacanian theory. So while Artaud writes that, quote, "my body is mine from the head to the feet, there is no one inside. I have absolutely no internal function, no localization of internal conscience." The body without organs is the body captured and defined and in principle divided by the others, successfully subjected to hierarchical order, whereas the body of the void is the true body, existing alongside or outside, as it were, of the organ body. One can see this notion in the later reflection by Deleuze and Guattari, where the body without organs has, quote, "nothing to do with the body itself or an image of the body," end quote. To Artaud, paradoxically, this constitutes an affirmative matter. Artaud writes, "I seek a body consistent, irreal, animated, corporeal, as one anchored in my brain, as the one anchored in my brain, and I seek it not in infinite idea, but finite, not in infinity, but in space, not in deepening in existence, but in affirmative matter. The body remote, impossible, imperceptible, unobstructed by any descriptive, discriminating conscience, and which nevertheless will be more and more there, weighing down and arresting the conscience which wants to traverse it." It was this idea that Artaud could guide one to a new understanding of affirmative matter that led to the Tel-Kel convocation on Artaud in 1972, and this is when they were in their full Marxist-Maoist phase, then, Philip Solier's and his collaborators. The notion, however strange perhaps on the face of it, that Artaud could contribute to a more adequate and radical theory of materialism. Such investigations continue today, and researchers that form a part of what Matteo Pasqualini, just a month ago in Berlin, for instance, has described as, "it is in order to understand the body that we start from the mind. It is from the very core of the bios that we find the nous. The cognitive will be considered as something that doesn't come after, but innervates the very flesh in its constitution. In this view, it is the brain that will be, quote, illustrated as the first model and terrain of biopower." The crises and fault lines clearly evident of a globalized corporate capitalism that indeed seems to at long last abut its limits are going to reflux, in Frederick Nayat's term, the idea it's turning back on itself in all these different aspects and ways that it's finally reaching a sort of high watermark, has renewed the urgency of a kind of rampant Spinozaism already underway for some decades. You see in the political thing of Balibar, a whole number of people may agree. Such discussions can rely on Terence Deacon's work on the coevolution of language in the brain, as Deacon argues, quote, "the most extensive modification take place in human brain evolution, the expansion of the cerebral cortex, specifically the prefrontal cortex, reflects the evolutionary adaptation to this intensive working memory processing demand imposed by symbol learning. This emphasis goes beyond the sculpting or conditioning of the brain by its environment, the historical pattern of perception, to the brain's extraordinary neural plasticity." Again, Deleuze has a central place of recognition here, as in his conversation with Tony Negri, where he remarks, "I think subjectification, events, and brains are more or less the same thing." As Charles T. Wolfe points out, these concerns go beyond finding neural correlates of aesthetic experience, as we're trying to do, or Semenzeki, to the double-barreled idea one finds in Deleuze, that, quote, "a new kind of brain is required to grasp new spatial, temporal, perceptual, chromatic, affective arrangements, such as the modern city, the neorealist city, the et cetera, which is some of the first motivations for Deleuze writing those things in the cinema world. And conversely, these arrangements give rise to a new kind of brain. It is a very unique understanding of neuroplasticity. It is an added advantage to Deleuze's approach, Wolf continues, that he bypasses linguistic theories of mind or of getting one stuck in debates over the status of representations. And this view to which Deleuze has so dramatically contributed is the brain itself, less in its static anatomical being, Wolf writes, than its dynamic physiological being, and actually then displays features that reflect its embeddedness in or belonging to the social world. The externalist Spinoza's point to be derived here is that we can only have knowledge about the inner states of others, and indeed of our own, thanks to the overall structure of symbolic activity, a la Deacon, which externally exhibits the existence of such states and further creates the structure in which such states emerge. Wolf hails this step from the social mind to the social brain, even if it is not quite yet an adequate theory of the transformative potential or dimension of the plastic, socially plastic brain. This analysis of the social brain that cannot be subtracted, extracted, or abstracted from its surrounding and constituting web of relations, that is irreducibly social, may seem to take us far from Arto, unless we recall that Spinoza's Ethics of 1677, at least for Deleuze and Guattari, was the elaborate complement, armature, and explanation of the body without organs. The body without organs from the point of view of health, so to speak, rather than the body without organs from Arto's standpoint of illness. And Arto never fails to insist on his sickness, as much as the greater insight, as in his peer group of Baudelaire, Hippocrate, de Noval, that can be gleaned from illness. And in Arto's late proclamation, whether the February 1947 essay on Van Gogh, The Man Suicided by Society, or To Have Done with the Judgment of God, were shot through and irradiated with the social, and were immediately read as such, hence the banning of the latter. Arto proclaims a total invasion or obliteration of the brain or interiority of self, while also pronouncing a possible metamorphosis in the unorganized body, that often to Arto seems a perpetual or infinite project, or even an impossible one. Yet in passages in his late notebooks, Arto confirms that he has, at least in moments, accomplished this. In December 1947, for instance, Arto writes that he has indeed made a body. In To Have Done with the Judgment of God, Arto describes an army descending from the rites that abolished the Christian cross to enforce this body without organs. Arto becomes infatuated with this idea of having a private army, right? Like Mishima later does. I think every writer should have a private army with them to enforce these ideas. This power of transformation of the body without organs replaces for Arto the place previously held by the mysterious movement of the hieroglyphic, a university of lines that the body without organs erases. Whereas Cubism, in Arto's view in the 1920s, demonstrated this occult reality, Picasso, Arto wrote, portrayed a living geometry. For the later Arto, it challenges it. Writing George Brock, 16th of January 1947, Arto claimed that, quote, Cubism is a putting into question of the linear occult world, and is even more a matter of the tear of internal tissue, since the task of painting is to confound and confuse the internal mechanics of an already made cosmos. The early Arto saw a successful theater of cruelty in Lucas van Leyden's painting, quote, knowledge of certain secrets concerning linear harmony and of means of making it act directly in the brain, like a physical reaction. The later Arto seeks a similar combustion, but in order to uproot and destroy this hieroglyphic patterning or linear harmony, that is the con job of gods and priests. What for Arto is an all-consuming, devouring reality has its complement in David Brodowick's version of the social hieroglyph operating in digital or postmodern electronic society. Using Jean-François Lyotard's notion of the figural, Brodowick broaches that this is the overwhelming form of our epoch, where the visible and the expressible are hopelessly intertwined and interdependent as in a kind of hieroglyph, where one aspect has to be read through the other. This was inspired in part by what Roderick called his music television epiphany, becoming, quote, astonished by how fluidly text was spatialized, thus losing its uniform contours, fixed spacing, and linear sense, and how precisely space was textualized. That is, how the Euclidean solidity of the image was fragmented, rendered discontinuous, divisible, and liable to recombination in the most precise ways. Suddenly the image was becoming articulable, indeed discursive like never before. This world of new media, Roderick continues, can help us challenge in new ways the ontological gesture that separates the arts of time from the arts of space. In so doing, the visible is no longer banished from the realm of discourse, which is reserved for linguistic senses, the site of rational communication, and the articulable or enunciable can regain its powers of plastic transformation. Roderick generalizes the age of new media as one of figural discourse in hieroglyphic form, trying to get at and define media that is, quote, ever permutable, a fractured, fracturing, or fractile space ruled by time and difference. It knows nothing of the concept of identity. Having nothing to do with the categories of either high or low culture, a notion like the figural, rather, Roderick writes, becomes the logic of mass culture itself, in that it's absolutely everywhere. Roderick's generalization of the movement from code to image and back in such a fluid manner is certainly open to question. Using Lyotard's highly mobile and inescapable force field figural may be an overreach in describing media that are also in many respects highly conventional and so strongly discursive that can be reduced quite easily oftentimes. What is useful about it in our context is how it lends what was once an avant-garde disruptive force, the resort to hieroglyphs as a powerful otherness that granted quicker access to the unconscious among its other virtues, is now quite run-of-the-mill, in fact omnipresent and far from liberating, is the preferred form of new communication media in the stage of post-Fordist cognitive capitalism. It appears more as the strange world of the Oglethorpe Group's Anathema, the film in 2011, seamless, all-encompassing, as completely technological as it is cosmological, unthinkably ordinary and utterly foreign, free-floating in a space of signs. The power of capture inherent in this new media has been highly dramatized recently in analyses of cognitive capitalism that characterize it without any irony or metaphoric intent as a form of sorcery, the way Artaud described it. For pharmaceutical activist publisher Philippe Pinier and philosophy of science Isabel Stengers, capitalism is, quote, a system of sorcery without sorcerers thinking of themselves as such, and to describe it as such is, quote, not to take an ethnological risk, but a pragmatic one. It is part of Pinier's and Stenger's wager, a profoundly Artaudian one without ever citing Artaud, to portray the situation in such drastic, stark, and non-modern terms, precisely to underline our vulnerability. To assume protection against sorcery already exists is simply part of the hubris and false inheritance of modernity for them. For this analysis, Pigneurs and Stengers feel they are indebted to Marx, whose categories of exploitation, they write, got the measure of the power of capitalist capture, of what it's like to live in a capitalist culture. After all, in the first volume of Capital, Marx had described commodity fetishism as a kind of magic, and capitalism as a system where social relations between people took the form of, quote, a fantastic form of a relation between things. Excuse me. What Pinier and Stengers proposed is an alliance between the practices of experimental science, of political creation of affinity groups, and the techniques of counter-sorcery, claiming that what makes people uncomfortable, what is difficult to accept, is that witches, and witches are their explanation, or their example here, or pragmatic, or radically pragmatic, truly experimental technicians experimenting with effects and consequences. To evoke the goddesses, for example, they write, is to tap into the powers of imminent change. As in Stalhawk's claim, the goddess changes everything she touches, and everything she touches changes. Hailing the efficacy of the witch's gesture has no truck with faith or belief, but rather is based on their experimental procedure, the fabricated nature of their rituals, and, quote, the undecidability that they confront us with. Problematically, the authors recommend the witch's circle without stepping into it themselves, another Artaudian dilemma that Artaud is forever calling one to enter his delirium and pain while simultaneously insisting that this would be impossible. In contrast, I don't know how many people are familiar with her work, anthropologist Jean Favre Sada, in her research into witchcraft in the French Bocage countryside, she did back in the 80s, becomes fully part of the symbolic and performative network she's studying, fully participating in its spells and rituals. So she's very much an alternative in terms of becoming what you are writing about, right, or observing. This analysis by Stengers and Pinier complements that of the collective cocoon, who take Marx's warning of commodity fetishism as fantastic form, quite literally as a case of possession of one's body, mind, actions, and soul. This is possession, they write, by a psychic economy, that for Tikkun is the only level on which, in which the economy is real and concrete, and they have a very long, if not convoluted, anthropological post-situation analysis of how they got to this conclusion, which we, I'm not going to time to go into. Now, maybe we can talk about that later. The operations of the corporate capitalist economy, therefore, conjure realms of imagination, of desire, the shaping of man into an economic creature that, without any exaggeration, functions as a kind of black magic, which is what they call it. To speak of sorcery in this manner, as Kinnear's and Stenger's write, naming it in such a way that allows its type of power to be encountered, implies a very different politics and relation than the coming to consciousness required by older analyses of alienation. These kind of analyses actually have very little to do with that, except in the case of Tikkun, if we were really looking at that. Are the coming together of the commons, as in Michael Hart, Tony Negri. Their analyses may also rely on the social brain and its malignant capture, but broach no solution of neuropower, what Charles Wolfe has called the transformative powers of the socialist context, this capacity of the brain to transform and change. In league with them, the fullest and most Sartorian analysis of our current dilemma may well be that of Frederick Nayat, who in his 2005 third expose and 2009 book on Artaud describes current globalization as the fullest revelation of the necessary links between capital, surplus value, being, and God in the West's perpetual war economy. Nayat has the virtue, for my purposes, of taking Artaud's diagnosis of the West as bewitched in all its seriousness. Upon Artaud's return to Paris from the Rondeau's asylum in 1946, he often proclaims a global delirium of bewitchment. Quote, one bewitches, the mass bewitches, individuals bewitch. All the world knows it, nobody says a word. So again, Artaud is the only one speaking of this sort of collective spelldom that's going on. Yet Artaud's rage against the envoltement of especially the Western world, as truly global and far-reaching as it was also an invective that continued to be directed to the black magic sent against him in particular. So it is hardly as simple a matter as a mere reversal of the bewitchment Artaud felt had tormented in the beginning from his climb up to the Sierra Tarahumara's 10 years before. In Artaud's sorcery against sorcery, what is outside and what is inside is a line that never ceases to be challenged. When Artaud rages that, quote, one has reinvented microbes finally to impose a new idea of God, Nayat comments that Artaud's Cold War rant is also aimed against nuclear proliferation. The avatar of God, this is the bomb. The vampirism and parasitism of being that Artaud continually denounces identifies the ontology of transnational capitalist expansion and its myriad levels and incarnations. Nayat's view of Artaud carries its own reductions, however. His stressing of how Artaud at the end of his life is assassinating magic and fighting sorcery underestimates how caught up he continues to be in such. Nayat writes that the only time Artaud believes in God is the brief period in Rodez, which when he later admits that himself that he's mentally ill. Yet Artaud's actual record, as evidenced in the voluminous notebooks, is far, far messier and profoundly conflicted, to say the least. These are battles between God and Satan. Right? The existence of evil is something Artaud never, ever dismisses. Evil is a very profound reality in the constitution of the material substrate of the world for Artaud. And it's very difficult, it's really impossible, let me just say that, to demonstrate such a clean break as what Nayat is trying to see in Artaud. Although Nayat does give some hint of the confusion of this when writing about this war of clashing magics and sorceries, when Nayat writes, how to know from the outside which one to stop, which I think is actually a very profound comment on Artaud's notebooks. Nayat's sometimes blunt advocacy of Artaud as the voice of so much unvoiced in Western culture follows the guise of Foucault's The Soul, Prison of the Body, as in Artaud's Shit to the Spirit, Artaud's idea that, quote, the self is not the body is the self, which is something Godard used to tell his cinematographers before films. We use this as an adage of going by this. Nayat's critique seeks to develop this elaboration of Artaud's body without organs. You know, this part I am going to skip in the moment, just in case I am running over. I'll go back to that. Anyway, these are different ways of updating the analysis you find in Deleuze and Guattari and Antic, Oedipus and Phasm and Plateaus of what would be an adequate or accurate analysis of capitalism. and I'm still going through some of this. I think one of the very problematic aspects of that, which I'm sure some of you and you're aware of in Anti-Oedipus and Thousand Plateaus, the body without organs, which is a figure of this kind of groundless ground of any kind of desire, the existence of capital itself is a body without organs, right? Which is one reason Artaud lends himself to that quite, and my conclusion actually come back to that. So Artaud has served as a flashpoint in the past, coalescing in various avant-garde artistic and theoretical explorations for the American artists around David Tudor and John Cage at Black Mountain College in the 1950s, and the political and environmental poetics of the Wing of the Beat generation. There's a whole host of lines in Allen Ginsberg's Howl that come very directly from Artaud. The invention of Butoh in Japan in 1959 are for the French thinkers reconsidering the language of the relation of language and materiality after 1968. And Artaud has that possibility of offering such a substrate again. In current circumstances, Artaud's relentless critique of representation take on new life and significance, as Stephen Barber has concluded, in a contemporary moment in which representation assumes a vastly expanded and unprecedented power in its obliterating contact with the human body as well as with urban environments and creative media, Artaud's anatomization of the process of representation is no longer obtuse, but rather exact and revelatory. Artaud's assault on representation is first waged on behalf of the true lines that constitute reality. A powerful occult geometry representation can only occlude, and that even the militant avant-garde movement of surrealism be judged unable to reach. That evolves into an attack even more violent in the last 2.5 years of his life, where any sacred hieroglyph in the esoteric thought that husbands it seems itself a false representational raiment and is simply despised. I hold it now in the real and in my body like a toilet broom, Artaud writes. Artaud is no longer searching for geomagnetic stress points or the zigzags of an ultimate reality, and in writing about zigzags, he uses exactly the same word Eisenstein writes when he talks about the snake-like movement of montage in filmmaking. His lines and his drawings and his notebooks are artifacts of how what was once an element of moving image of a cosmological hieroglyph has now disintegrated into unremitting conflict that revolves around this creation of Artaud's body without organs. It's this body without organs that enables Artaud to abject all signs and is the function of his drawings, themselves animated, protected bodies. Are his screams that aim at unrepeatability of gesture as in to have done with the judgment of God? Artaud is discussing the virtual body as early as 1925, and in one of his foreshadowings of the body without organs is his letter of 1933, where he writes it's mistaken to look at the body as a fixed and impermeable organism. It is rather only, quote, provisional stratifications of states of life. So Artaud is early on prefiguring the body as an image of the anorganic vitality that traverses it long before he feels called upon to double it. For Artaud, it was a matter of evoking the movements of the life plane, yet his later body without organs is such an extreme auto-creation, substituting autocathonous reality for God, partaking of what he characterized in his essay on Van Gogh as direct creation, that it arguably blasts beyond a Deleuzian philosophy of immanence as well. Paradoxically, it is Artaud's very extremity that renders him useful today. Far from splintered ideas that gave rise to this or that experiment and performance, as important as many of those continue to be, Artaud's adamant advocacy of the walking will is exercised at a stunning intersection of the virtual with space and time and what is so inadequately termed affect. What Guattari termed the reconquest of a degree of creative autonomy, and what Pinier and Stengers would rather simply term reclaiming, is a reactivation and reappropriation, but not of any original lost substance or tradition that can simply be reinstituted. Artaud is often tread that way. Nevertheless, it affords a means of breaking the spell in Pinier and Stengers' parlance to, quote, become capable once again of inhabiting the devastated zones of experience. This Artaud surely did, not only producing far more in the last 2.5 years of his life than previously better known work up to 1936, the work that up to a certain time he's been more famous for, but also possibly work of more lasting significance. If today digital media design situations that produce various simultaneous planes of temporality that cannot be completely assimilated to their spatial base or entanglements, these enactments partake of the same dynamics of Artaud's notebooks, that for Artaud is a release of the body into infinity, composed of multiple planes of time. It is the body without organs that transforms what Artaud deplores as the uniformity of human time, that order which asphyxiates us. This deadly order of time is a primary cause of humanity trapped in the oral anal tract or canal in the servitude of the physical body, which is Artaud's great target and terror. His notebooks are the laboratory for its transformation, which is something I think we've seen discussed a bit today. In passages from his January 1948 notebook, for example, Artaud uses virtually all the conjugations and senses of the verb passer, a traverser, de passer, so that it's impossible to distinguish what is before and after, in front or behind, above or below, enacting the dance Artaud calls for and to have done with the judgment of God, that dance inside out as in the delirium of the dance halls, and that inside out will be his true inside out. This is not a question of opposing chronos or human time to the eternal time of God or the God's aeon. This would be the Christian duality Artaud explicitly denounces. Rather, it is a matter of what Artaud calls, quote, the endless duration of the body, of the same man in the same body undergoing time without stop and space eternally fathomed. This creation and enactment of a semi-paternal time is part and parcel of the attempt to reassemble a new human body, since it is in the notebooks where, quote, I have made things one after the others and not at the same time. In the sense of time as a function or a series of events, Artaud writes, quote, that are produced without filling it. The time of a bus conductor, Artaud writes, is not the same as a merchant or a writer at his desk, so his creations challenge this uniformization of bodies. Artaud describes this process as, quote, a movement with which rocks the breath, as a great reversal, the revival of Antonin Artaud, the non-coffin. Artaud overthrows the corralling of time, typical of most tribal ritual, where time is suppressed in the interest of spatialization of phenomena. These rites work hard to contain any spillage, any leaks, back into the unity of the world that is also the unity of the tribe. By staying in what Jose Gil has called the recurrent flux, Artaud opens to the potentially unlimited positivicity of the body with the organs, which of course is part of the big appeal and with the losing Guattari that it's not reliant on a thermodynamic model of energy, right, that you would find in Freud, for example, their target antithesis. Not only does this alter many analyses of new media that have been framed around spatialization, which would include accounts by Lev Manovich, Sean Moores, Phil Graham, as well as the well-known metaphors of William Gibson's cyberspace or Marshall McLuhan's global village, and the early Artaud is sometimes enlisted here as well, as in Timothy Baker's recent book, Time in the Digital. It opens out onto transformational qualities, what Rory Ascott has called the metaphysical impasses inherent in the media. Artaud does this not simply to the evocation of what Whitehead called temporal thickness, but to Artaud's relay of a catastrophe. This was a profound distress and dissonance, even in Artaud's earlier enigmatic calling upon the qualities of the hidden mirror glass and their whirring hallucinatory power, as he described it in his writing on the Balinese dancers that he saw in 1931. But in the final Artaud, the different sensory modalities or faculties are at war. Sound, image, text, and even their constituent bodily sources canceling each other out in an apocalyptic engulfment. It is why he would regard to have done with the judgment of God, quote, a miniature model, unquote, of the theory of cruelty, which is a very significant thing. Artaud never anywhere says, this is exactly what I'm talking about, this is a model of what the theory of cruelty is, but he does say that about the radio broadcast, a sound work. It is finally Artaud's sense of catastrophe that brings his relevance and urgency far beyond the analogy that digital processes lead one unto a processual paradigm beyond any sense of subject heard, immersing one into, in Andrew Murphy's words, an ongoing and prolific series of relations between the techniques of perception, mediation, animated and mutated matter, and our own nervous elements, which we often regard as closest to our sense of self. In what Guattari called the fuller disequilibrium of a virtual universe, and Deleuze the spherical body, Artaud, upon his return to Paris in 1946, insists, I am not forced into a made space. I create it without cease, without possible halt, forever. Artaud, at the end of his life, opposes two occults. The true occult that he describes as the extension of the visible and the sensible into the world he's penetrating, to the generalized bewitchment that submits the visible to the invisible. And for all the closeness of Guattari and Deleuze's reading of Artaud, Artaud's catastrophe entailing the erasure of the line would seem ultimately to challenge their philosophy of immanence as well. So Artaud is pushed beyond this as well in terms of a theoretical or conceptual limit. With losing Guattari, an absolute line of flight is not possible. Vanishing lines, for example, as in Western perspective painting that took hold in the early Renaissance in this view, are not lines of flight at all, but rather are fixed vectors, flows that have been reterritorialized. That's an example from Mark Vogt and John Curtet's book on the Louvre that came out a few years ago. Artaud challenges our aims to cross precisely molar lines, as in the line from life to death, lines that for Deleuze and Guattari are absolute and cannot be crossed. What constitutes crossing line for Foucault is bound up with what is on the other side of knowledge and power. Likewise for Deleuze, the line that is no longer a power relation, Deleuze found, quote, difficult to talk about, unquote. Its location is, quote, everywhere thought confronts something like madness and life something like death. Liminal locations, in other words, where Artaud spent an extraordinary amount of time. This is, quote, the line outside that Deleuze writes as our double, with all our double's otherness. This knowledge as a necessary fold of the outside or double, Artaud invokes as a catastrophe. The void where we do not see what we speak about or speak about what we see. This negotiation of incommensurable forms that cannot be defined in terms of the other can only be subject to what Deleuze calls in Artaudian terms an audiovisual battle. A matter of a pure relation between forms that emerges in the irreducible separation of forms. The later Artaud affirms these chiasms as irreparable. So far from merely confirming directionality and process and the new digital convergences of multiple senses of space and time, and even bodily mutation, at least in Gregory Little's sense in his Avatar Manifesto of what he called unconsumable self-images, Artaud opens to the unremitting conflict of orientation and the ongoing virtualization of the world. And that's what I saw. Capitalism, to take a few examples by Philippe Pignat and Isabel Stenger, is Frédéric Niat and the collective Tycoon, where the movements of political economy are indeed nothing less than black magic, as Artaud diagnosed it. For Artaud, who claimed he had been hexed ever since his trek up to the Sierra Tarahumaras to partake in peyote rituals with the Tarahumaras in September 1936, this was a combat of sorcery and counter-sorcery, a desperate cosmological war against demonic invasive forces. Paradoxically, it is this late Artaud, especially after his release from Rodez Asylum in May 1946, that sees himself at war with the occult, whether these are occult representations or occult forces. Artaud, making a strange figure on the Paris Metro, was constantly making signs and heretic gestures, warding off his numerous enemies. The essential, if preliminary, question I'm trying to draw from Artaud has to do with this fiercely debatable role of representation and representational processes that we've heard quite a bit about today so far. Artaud's assault on representation has only solidified and intensified in ferocity at the end of his life, in her paper so well, but I think you'll see some of these issues that come out, one of which, I think, at least in Deleuze and Guattari's reading, you know, the other big model for Body Without Organs, besides Artaud, is Spinoza. And I think if you look in the kind of social, political context of those, there's a very huge bifurcation there in what that might mean. So I think that's something that comes out of this, to an extent. I think it's okay for time. I'll see. Because I usually do have a lot of showing film clips, but I'm not doing any of that. So I hope I didn't go over dose on the text here. But we'll see. I think it's going to work out. We'll see here, but anyway, so one of the most striking aspects of Artaud's legacy, Artaud predicted in 1948, and then this is a quote that Roz has already introduced us to, that his present body would fly into pieces, and under 10,000 notorious aspects, a new body would be assembled in which you will never again be able to forget me. Is that what is most mad and delusional about him in his lifetime, where he was stigmatized as schizophrenic and subjected to electroshock treatments, survives and even thrives today in analyses of contemporary issues occurring in early and mid-20th century art, whether one looks at Cubism, Abby Warburg's Atlas Project, Sergei Eisenstein films, or Ernst Filonosa and Ezra Pound's use of the Chinese ideogram as a revivifying force for avant-garde poetics. The late Artaud, on the other hand, has few, if any, compliments indeed. As for his previously dear hieroglyphs, Artaud writes in 1946 that, quote, all the keys of their so-called occultism die out in the finally useless and ominous convolutions of brain matter. In his so-called associations that Artaud considered his most honed work, he writes, Papa Mama itself will have ceded the place to man without hieroglyphics and secret keyboard, that is, without signs and without mysticism, without any of the zigzags of sacred geometry, or sometimes Artaud talks about occult geometry, quite frequently in the 20s and 30s. Artaud's reference to brain matter in this devolution or uselessness of the hieroglyphs is far from accidental or fortuitous, since as with the final Artaud, what is at stake is a, quote, harsh and immediate conception of life in which the body is the foundation. Situating, I think there really is a whole new relevance to Artaud now. And there are these, we're already in this, going in the second decade of the 20th century, the way he's had very powerful impact and relevance at different periods. I'm going to touch on just a little bit. And so I'm trying to kind of situate him exactly why that's happening or why there's a big potential for that with this sort of maybe new media society of digital censoring and how we want to talk about that. So that's sort of the backdrop of this. And it's a little too preliminary for me because some of the issues you can't really be gone into in a short, this final Artaud or late Artaud. And what can possibly constitute a subversion of them in an inexorable digital sensorium? What I'm going to suggest here is that it's this later or final Artaud's experience with the Terror of Mura's was such a dramatic rupture that one can easily speak of a pre and post Terror of Mura Artaud. That in many crucial respects was a total reversal of the early one. What is the one that provides these intriguing inroads into the present? So key to this new relevance is Artaud's ferocious rejection of the occult, systems of which he was deeply immersed in the 1930s especially, or proposal of a counter-occult, counter-sorcery, and the linked transformation and discarding of the whole notion of a matrix of all-powerful hieroglyphics that constitutes the moving forces of the universe that are featured so saliently throughout his famous theater manifestos published in 1938, and that Artaud went to Mexico to witness. He argued that indigenous peoples there were in contact with these primal realities. Artaud's obsession with or advocacy of hieroglyphics makes him, as he realized, part of a